Well, what's up, Harvest? It is good to be in God's house with God's people all around Chicago. I saw a miracle that happened this morning as I came into church. I just want to tell you about it. I was walking to the front door of the church, and I saw a Packers fan that was coming to serve with a sweatshirt on. Unbelievable. And then sat in the front row. God is moving in this church in some ways. We need to pray, Bears fans, that the Lord would move a little stronger in this place. It is good to be in God's house. I'm Pastor Ed, and we've been in this series, Just Jesus. This is the fourth installment of the series, and I want to invite you to turn in your Bibles to chapter 2 of the book of Mark. Chapter 2 of the book of Mark, all around our churches here in our amazing city of Chicago. There are Bibles that are provided for you. If you don't have one, take it home with you. It is our gift to you from Harvest Bible Chapel. We want to be in God's Word today. It's been great to see on Instagram so many people back in town, some folks back from college, homecoming, powder puff games. It's just amazing what happens. But I believe that there are people who've come to church today that need a word from God. They don't need jokes. They don't need me. They need a word from Jesus Christ. And so I want to invite you to pray with me as we invite Jesus to be the center of the next few minutes that we have together. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to share your word with your people. And God, I beg you for your anointing and your power this morning in your word. We need a word from you. We need a word that will transform our lives and that will help us not only be encouraged, but to live differently. God, our church needs a word from you today. And so we ask you to be in this place, in this moment, as I share the word. I ask you to remove sin from my life that would keep this word from going forward. And we pray it in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, if you are there in Mark chapter 2, we're sharing with you a little bit about a story that may sound familiar if you've been at Harvest for a few months. It may sound familiar. You're like, oh, this Mark chapter 2, there's a paralyzed man. I think we've talked about that. And you would be right. In God's sovereignty, we're back at this passage, but we looked at it this summer as a part of our faith series. And it's amazing, isn't it, how you can look at God's word and see different things every time you look at it. God moved me in the text this week, and I pray that this morning be able to bring this to you. But it reminded me of a 18th century evangelist. His name is George Whitefield. And George used to preach in desolate places and open-air arenas, and thousands of people would come to hear him preach the word of God. And they asked him one time after one of his sermons, George, I know that you're popular and famous and people want to come and hear the word of God. How do you know that your sermon was good? And George said, oh, that's really easy. Either someone got saved and came to Jesus Christ, or someone got angry and let me know about it. Well, I pray that the day that it would be more of the former and less of the latter, but the word of God is powerful. And we've been watching in chapter 1 the last 2 weeks. I thank God for Pastor Dave Stone and Pastor Eddie Hoagland, how they brought so beautifully what has been happening in the text. And just to remind you, if you haven't been with us, in chapter 1, about midway through, Jesus called four fishermen to him. And he didn't stop there. He healed a man who was oppressed by a demon. And then he continued, as we look at the text, that there was a feverish mother-in-law of one of those that he called, and he healed her, and just for good measure, she began serving them. And then it continues as we just look at this video that is playing. Jesus continues, and many more people who were sick and oppressed came to Jesus, and he healed them, and he just was busy all through the night, and then he got up early, as Pastor Eddie Hoagland encouraged us. How many of us had the privilege to get up early before day at least once this last week and pray? Isn't that awesome? I'm gonna tell Pastor Eddie he might want to save that for a little while. We don't want to do that every day. But, you know, it's just awesome to get up before day and to spend time with God. And then we saw Jesus do something amazing. He touched a leper, an outcast, and he healed him and restored him to the community. And today we're going to see Jesus encounter a paralyzed man. We're going to work through the text slowly, verse 1 through 12. If you've got the scripture, say, I got it. If you don't, say, Pastor, back that thing up. All right, I didn't hear that, so let's go. We're going to read the first 4 verses. And when he returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. And many were gathered together so that there was no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them. And they came bringing to him a paralytic carried by 4 men. And verse 4 says this, and when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. As we look at the text, there's a few things that just immediately jump off the page. And I want to share with you a couple of them right off the bat. The first thing is this. Jesus introduced a new way of teaching with power and authority. With power and authority. We see Jesus here using an ATM, a teaching moment. And we see him using this ATM, and he has come back to Capernaum, and we know that he's come back to Capernaum because in the first chapter, if you look at verse 15 and 17, Jesus was invited to a house. I thought Mark was very liberal in saying that Jesus went back home. We all know that Jesus didn't own a home. Jesus was a professional squatter of people's homes. So Jesus, as theologians let us know, it was likely in Peter's home or Peter's mom's home. So here he is, just, I've been poured out, been all through Galilee. I'm just trying to come home and get some rest. And then somebody put on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram that Jesus was back home. I love how the text lets us know it was reported that he was at home. And it was reported that he was at home, and people began to gather together. As I imagine this text, she's not present here, but I wonder what Peter's mom was thinking when she started to see people gather around the house. I know some of us are not tidy, but a few of us maybe like to have the house looking good when we have guests. And I'm sure that she was excited to see Jesus, but I just get this feeling that there was a moment where someone said, hey, Jesus is back. She's like, oh, man, we're going to have to clean tonight. People are just showing up all over the place. They can't even get in the front door. But I love this chaotic scene. We look at chaos and we look at distraction. But it's amazing that Jesus Christ, when he sees something like this, he sees opportunity. Opportunity to reveal the power of God. And so the Bible lets us know that Jesus was teaching and preaching the word to him. The question should arise for us that the text doesn't reveal, and Mark doesn't reveal the details of any of Jesus' sermons until chapter 4. It's amazing that all we see is what happens when Jesus preaches, but we don't see the details. So we have to read the book and find out what is the gospel that Jesus preached. Well, thank you. I'm glad you asked what that was. I'd like to share a little bit about that. The gospel that Jesus preached was the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? It's important for context to understand what is going on here, that Jesus is preaching the kingdom of God, and the people who were listening, primarily a Jewish audience at this time, they had hopes that were embodied in the philosophy and the mindset of the kingdom of God. And here's what it is. They thought that the kingdom of God would one day remove all evil from the world, and it would inaugurate an amazing season of blessing and prosperity and joy. This is what people believed that the Messiah, Yahweh, the Great One, this is what he would bring. But it's interesting when you look at Jesus and you look at when he preaches about the kingdom of God. It embodies various elements. It's not just spiritual, sin being destroyed and conquering the power of death. That's one part of it. But there's two other elements that Jewish people were looking at very closely. It was political as well. That God's people thought that they would be released from the power of oppression of Roman rule and those who had oppressed them for so many decades and years and generations, that the Messiah would come and release and liberate them. It would be spiritual liberation. It would be political liberation. But there was a third component as well, that they thought that it was also economic, that we would see prosperity and we would see blessing. They had expectations for what Jesus should look and feel like. I love theologian Ronald Kernighan in his commentary on the book of Mark, this quote that I want to share with you now. The kingdom of God expresses the hope for a world in which the powers of sin, death, and darkness are replaced by peace, justice, and worship of the one true God. In essence, it is the hope that the rule of God would be restored over all creation. Jesus came to preach two things, to repent and to believe. But it's interesting that the expectations that people had of Jesus and what he was going to reveal that the kingdom of God was really like was on a collision course. Their expectations were going to be disappointed. I believe that the children of Israel are a lot like us in the modern day church today. I think we like to pick pieces of the gospel that are convenient for us. We love when people talk about Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and full of grace and love, amen? But we don't tweet some of the comments that Jesus makes that are a little controversial. We like to just skip over that. We don't want to talk about when he starts talking about sheep and goats. We don't want to talk about what happens when he looks at you and says, "Get behind me, Satan." We don't want to talk about those elements, but those are all elements of the kingdom of God. And Jesus uses 65 words in our text today, only 65 words. And in those 65 words, he is going to begin to make clear a march toward his death. And he's going to make clear that the kingdom of God, he has power and authority to say some things, to do some things, and to reveal some things. And in the text, we find out that four men came to him. Verse 3, they came to him and they removed the roof above him. And when they made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. I'm not going to spend a lot of time in this moment, but these are four of my heroes in the Bible. Can I talk about them just for a couple moments? I love the courage and the commitment that these men had to bring this man to Jesus. The Bible doesn't let us know the relationship that these four men had with the paralyzed man. We have no idea. All we know is that these brothers brought this man to Jesus. They didn't just bring him to Jesus, but the Bible lets us know that there were so many people in the room and so many people at the front of the house that they took the liberty to go up the side of the house, get on the roof, and if you can imagine with me, Jesus presenting an amazing passage out of Isaiah about what the kingdom of God is like, and all of a sudden dirt starts to come down and mud and sticks down on him. And I'm sure that the security team at that moment got on alert. I'm sure that some brothers went upside of the house and said, "Hey, excuse me, God, what are you guys doing? What's going on?" They didn't stop. They didn't allow anybody to stop them. They continued digging this hole through the roof. And I can see our Lord and Savior looking up at the roof, probably with a smile, as this paralyzed man starts to come down in front of him. These four men had a plan. They believed that not just faith but they believed that they needed to put their faith into action. I don't know how many of you have ever been in a situation where you needed somebody to carry you to Jesus. Have anybody in the room around Chicago been in a place where you needed someone to carry you to Jesus? I agree. And when you're in that place, you might not be physically paralyzed, but you are mentally paralyzed. There's nothing that you can do in that moment but to rely on the help of someone else. And there's the tension that many of us have in the text. Some of us don't like to ask for help. We love to be the one carrying, but we don't like to be the one that's paralyzed. We don't like to be the one that reveals that I need help. 10 years ago, I was getting ready to speak to a group of people in Madison, Wisconsin, when I received a text. The text revealed to me that I needed to call home immediately and nothing else. I asked my cousin, why did I need to call home? And he said, Ed, you just need to call. You need to call home. I didn't call home at that moment because in that moment, I knew that somebody had died. And I knew that I had to go and share with God's people. And then my sister texted me and she said, you need to call right now. Have any of you ever received that phone call? At that phone call told me that my mother had died of a heart attack suddenly in her sleep. And in that moment, I knew there was only one thing that I could do is get out on my knees in that hotel room and ask the Lord for help because I didn't know what to do, folks. I know I'm supposed to be a pastor. I'm supposed to be able to call on the name of the Lord. Supposed to believe that my mother who knew the Lord was in a safer place. And we say things when people die that is really not very helpful. You know, Ed, time will heal all wounds. Newsflash, that's not true. Time heals many wounds. But my mother was dead, and I had to go minister to a group of people. And I could hear my mother saying to me, son, you need to get up and go preach the word. It was as clear as I'm standing here talking to all of you in Chicago. You need to go preach the word. And when I got to the arena, I will never forget what happened next. There was a group of people that came up to me who were friends, who I let know what had happened, just 3 or 4. And they prayed for me. They carried me to Jesus. And they told me, Ed, we'll put you on the next plane to go back home. We know that you need to be with your family. And I said, thank you very much. I don't need to go home. I'm right where the Lord wants me to be. My mother is with him. I need to get through the next hour. And then another friend drove in Madison, Wisconsin, to sit down with me at a coffee shop and brought me to Jesus. Every now and then, the Lord allows us in our history and in our time to see examples of a text, of what it looks like for someone to carry someone to Jesus. And during the World Championships recently, there was an amazing 5,000-meter race. And toward the end of the race, something happened that captivated the hearts of everyone in the stadium, and dare I say, many in the world. And it was this. Take a look.
Bremo Sukar Davo of Guinea-Bissau is literally dragging the brave Aruban Jonathan Busby to the finish line. They are going to finish together here. The crowd are on their feet. Anybody who's able, standing to salute this outstanding demonstration of sportsmanship and camaraderie. They didn't travel here to drop out. They traveled here to finish. Bremo Sukar Davo and Jonathan Busby, to a huge ovation from this massive crowd in Doha, have finished the 5,000 meters. And what a demonstration. of the esprit de corps and the friendship that exists between runners of all levels from all countries around the world.
Is that not amazing? I can't sit and not get excited about that moment. He finished the race. But I love the quote when they asked him after the race was over. They asked Brema Dabo, why in the world did you do what you did? Listen to what he said. He said, I saw that he wasn't running the right way. I could just preach right on that right there. I saw that he wasn't running the right way. He was leaning, and I realized he wasn't going to finish. And my thoughts were to help him finish, because that is the point. The point of carrying people to Jesus is not so that you become famous. The point of carrying people to Jesus is so that Jesus becomes famous. We know that Jesus, when he shows up, he changes everything. I wonder if you could just say that with me. When Jesus shows up, he changes everything. I believe that when Jesus reveals himself, the atmosphere changes. And Jesus did something else. He didn't just reveal himself in power and authority and teaching, but Jesus proved a new way of identity. He proved his identity this way by the forgiveness of sin. Verse 5 through 9 is the crux of the text, and it's incredibly intense. So I want to walk through these verses as we grow together in God's word. Verse 5 says, and when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Now some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? And immediately, Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus question within themselves, said to them, why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed, and walk? Now the plot thickens, ladies and gentlemen. Jesus Christ does something amazing. The Bible says that he looked at them, he saw them. Something happens when Jesus sees you. He doesn't confuse you with others. But I believe that Jesus, when he looked at them, the Bible does not designate, did he see four people or was he talking about all five of them? But I believe that all five of them had a measure of faith. They were putting their faith into action. And when Jesus saw their faith, he was compelled and he said, son, your sins are forgiven. Can I mess your theology up for a moment? Can anyone, by the raising of hands, show me where the paralyzed man prayed the sinner's prayer? Can anyone tell me where we see the paralyzed man actually asking for forgiveness of sins? Yeah, I had the same problem. We don't see it. But it gets even better. If I was one of the four men who were carrying this man to Jesus, y'all know that Pastor Ed is a little crazy. So I'm just going to reveal to you what I was thinking when I was reading the text. When I read the text, I think I would be the one who would raise my hand and say, excuse me, Jesus, we brought the paralyzed man here because we heard that you had some power, like to heal him. And you just said, his sins are forgiven. Is there anybody else that read the text that thought that something was missing here? What is it about the fact that Jesus sees a paralyzed man on a mat, but he forgives his sins? I'm amazed that sometimes I bring things to Jesus that I think are important, and Jesus reveals that there's something that's much deeper. See, we see in the text that there's a paralyzed man, and we believe that that presenting issue is the most important thing. But Jesus Christ, he sees something much, much deeper. He sees that the man has an issue that only he can reveal. It's his sin. Have you ever been in that place where Jesus has changed your plans? I think it's interesting sometimes that God has to break our expectations and dreams to save our soul. Sometimes God has to break our expectation and our dreams to save our soul. A question harvest all over Chicagoland: can God interrupt and wreck your plans to reveal his? These four men had a plan. They had a plan to bring Jesus, this paralyzed friend. They had a plan that should have worked, that Jesus immediately may choose to heal. But the plan changed because Jesus saw something that was much more different. But there's some other individuals that were also in the crowd. There were haters in the crowd. I know the Bible calls them scribes, but they're haters. That's who they are. They're haters. And it's interesting when haters show up in the crowd. This is newsflash for some of you. This isn't even in the notes, but everybody that's in the crowd isn't for you. Everybody that shows up at your party doesn't think you're awesome. Everybody that shows up to church is not at church to see Jesus. I know that's shocking, not at our church, at Harvest, at other churches. But at Harvest, everybody's here to see Jesus. But everybody in the crowd is not here to see Jesus. And the Bible lets us know that these scribes were there, and I love it that Jesus immediately perceived in their hearts what was going on. They didn't say this. Jesus perceived it. If I were a scribe in this moment, in this day, I'm telling you, I would have left right then. I am out. As soon as Jesus said the question, why do you perceive these things in your heart? He's on to me. But we should ask, who are scribes in the New Testament? Because it's going to be very important for the rest of the story. Scribes in the New Testament are influential authorities of the law. They knew backwards and forward the law of Moses. And every time that Jesus showed up, wherever he went, they were there with their notebooks, writing what he said and what he did. Oh, Jesus is sitting with sinners and eating with sinners. I'm going to write that down. Jesus is healing on the Sabbath. We're going to write that down. Jesus is not doing what he's supposed to be doing. He's not living out the letter of the law. We are going to be on you, Jesus, because you are messing up. Now, this isn't in the text, but there's one question I want to ask Jesus, and this is just personal for me. Y'all just follow along. But I wonder what it was like to be Jesus' campus pastor. I just get the feeling. I found one thing in the text kind of funny. I just laughed at myself. Y'all just forgive me and keep praying for your pastor. Just keep praying for me. But I think Jesus had an attendance problem at church. I think that Jesus got a few phone calls from the campus pastor just saying, hey, Jesus, we're just checking in on you. How are you doing? Haven't seen your church in a few weeks. Oh, I'm doing actually fairly well. There's a few hundred thousand people that I've been ministering to out in the countryside. We're having a great time and people are coming to Jesus. Can you imagine being his pastor? I think that there is a tension in the text that we forget between the scribes and between Jesus. People before Jesus came went to the temple to get instruction on the law. But now Jesus has interrupted the plan. He has upset the apple cart. The power has shifted, and people are going to desolate places to listen to this man who nobody really believes is Jesus Christ. And there is the passion and the tension in the text. And so Jesus asks questions. And when Jesus asks me questions, ladies and gentlemen, I get really concerned. Because when Jesus shows up, everything changes. And so Jesus asks two very simple questions. Guys, what do you think is easier? Do you think it would be easier to heal the paralyzed man? Or do you believe that it would be easier to forgive his sins? Just imagine Jesus taking a drink of water, strolling. Anytime anyone would like to answer that, that's here in this house, feel free. Because I'm Jesus, and because I have power and authority, I want you to know that I'm the Son of God. And this is the first time that he's referred to himself as this. It's going to happen 14 times in the book of Mark. The Son of God. What does that title mean? In the Old Testament, there were two different meanings for the Son of God. Either he was just a human or a man, a couple passages that bring that out, or Daniel chapter 7, verse 13 and 14, where the Son of God is referenced one time in Daniel, never again in the book, and the Son of God is referred as the man who has authority and power over all creation, all people, men and women, and his kingdom will have no end. These five words, "Son, your sins are forgiven," will change the course of history and begins the dance between the scribes and Jesus for years, the next 2 years. Listen to what the Bible says. After verse 9, he says this. "But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on all earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say, rise, pick up your bed, and go home." And he rose immediately and picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We've never seen anything like this." The third thing that we see in the text today that Jesus has done is a new way of experiencing life, healing. A new way of experiencing life, healing. It's interesting that Jesus shows through the healing of the man that I don't just have power, but I have authority. I already have it, and I have the right to use it. If Jesus would have just forgave his sins, it could have been accurately deemed blasphemy, because you can't see the evidence. You can't see the evidence of a man's heart. Only God knows that. That's the reason why the scribes were getting upset. Who do you think you are? You're not God. You don't know what's in a man's heart. Jesus, perceiving this, decides to do the dramatic. He drops the mic and he says three things. Arise. Can you imagine after years of being on a mat? I can't even imagine the joy and the eruption in the house when that man got up. Nothing else happened yet. He just got up. Because when Jesus shows up, everything changes. And so he gets up off the mat. He arises, but it's not enough for Jesus just to see him get up. Jesus says, "Arise, pick up your bed." Can you see it? Just rolling the mat. I think he was rolling it with a little bit of expeditiousness in his step. I'm rolling the mat. I'm putting it under my arms. And then he says, "Go home." Now, Pastor Eddie gave us an amazing story last week in chapter 1 that the leper, Jesus told him sternly, "Dude, just don't tell anybody. Just go show yourself to the priest." How'd that work out? Not too well. He told everybody. But here we see obedience. We see a paralyzed man whose life has changed, and he gets up and he goes home. Can I tell you what I think the scene looked like when he got home? I think the brother went off. I think he told his mom, "Hey, mama, can I have the favorite meal? Hey, y'all, look at this. I can move. I can go. I am healed." He told the people at home that he had been delivered, and I would have told him too. But the Bible doesn't stop the story there. Listen to what the text says at the end. It says, "So that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." How much is all, y'all? It's all. All the people in the room were amazed and said, "We haven't seen anything like this." Who were the people that were in the room? Four people that he called: Jesus, people who had came to hear him, and the scribes were there as well. But let me issue a caution as I get ready to land this sermon. The Bible says that all were amazed, but the question is, did all believe? I believe that people come to church every week and they're amazed at what happens and they don't believe. I believe you can see God do the miraculous. You can see God turn stones into bread. You can see amazing baptism testimonies and hug people and enjoy God's coffee and his air conditioning and his padded seats and leave this place all over our city and not believe. I want to challenge you today that somebody here under sound of my voice does not believe Jesus Christ, and today is your day. I want to pray that you would allow me to bring you to Jesus. Not to bring you to Harvest Bible Chapel. Not to bring you to a house. I want to bring you to Jesus. Amen. And so right now, all over Chicago, I want to pray a very simple prayer. I pray that my words will become your words. And we will bring you to Jesus. Let's pray. If you're here and you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, this is your moment. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. I'm just going to ask you to pray right where you are this simple prayer. Dear Jesus, I don't know you, but I want to. I believe that you died for my sins, and I believe that you, in fact, are the Lord and Savior. In this moment, I want to say yes to you, because I believe when you show up, you change everything. And I need you today. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that simple prayer today, I want you to know that the angels in heaven are throwing a house party right now. The block is hot for you because they are celebrating that you just came into the kingdom. Because when Jesus shows up, he changes everything. But for us who know Jesus Christ, I want to pray for us. And here's what I want to pray. I want to pray that this week we would do something together. What if we together invited somebody to Jesus? I didn't say invite him to church. Jesus didn't say, "Come follow me to the temple." He just said, "Come follow me." Here's the question. Who is it in your life that you need to bring to Jesus? Who is it in your small group that you need to bring to Jesus? They're walking with a limp. You can tell they're not running right. And you need to bring them to Jesus. Can I pray for you and me that we would bring them to Jesus? Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to share your word. Thank you for the anointing that destroys the yoke in our lives. God, there are people in this room, maybe even me, who need to be brought to you. I pray for boldness and faith that this week we would bring someone to you. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Never, ever forget. When Jesus shows up, changes everything. Let's stand and worship.